Shalom, shalom. First and foremost, giving all praises, glory, and honor be to Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, Bahashem Rakakwadash, and double honors to the apostles and elders of GMS, better known as Great Millstone, who rule well. Peace and salutations unto the hopeful elect, the tabernacle of David. And Salakia, Akiam, and Akwath, I'm a little bit congested, backed up. And I'm currently suffering from a sinus infection over the last 48 to 72 hours. So I do sincerely apologize for my voice sounding very low and mellow. But Lord's will, you're still able to hear me clearly. And I pray that this lesson, Salakia, will be edifying. So basically what I wanted to get into within this lesson is dealing with the phrase or term cherub, all right, or better known as what the scriptures also calls them, the chariots. And this image that you are currently viewing here on the screen is a representation of the heavenly host and their vehicles and what they ride in. Now, the scriptures sometimes will call them chariots, as we know, and we'll get some precepts, Lord willing, to back that up. But also they are known as cherubs. All right, which are heavenly beings, all right, living creatures. Now, what sparked me to go into this lesson is because there was a brother's live who I attended a few days ago, and the topic came up. And when a question was asked on the comment board, none of the brothers really went into it because this is a topic that hasn't been really broken down. This is something that really hasn't been going in too much, but it's actually basically is very simple with reading, studying, going into a few of the precepts and also into some biblical commentary, all right, and also some etymology of words, which we're going to grab, Lord willing, in this lesson. So the host of the live didn't give the correct understanding on it. And I said, you know what, let me go ahead and take this opportunity, Salakia, slip of the tongue. Let me take this opportunity to do a quick lesson and going into the understanding of cherubs. Now, I want to start here. I'm going to read in the background from the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary under the definition for the word cherub. All right. Or cherubim for plural. And it says here, the KJV has cherubims outside the Bible, and the English plural is cherubs. And it goes on to say, now, the cherubims are living, heavenly creatures in winged human animal form with the faces of a lion, ox, man, and eagle. It goes on to say, the guardians of Eden, Genesis 3:24, two golden cherubim were placed on a mercy seat above the ark, Exodus 25:18-22. Curtains of the tabernacle were embroidered with cherubim, Exodus 26:1. The Most High dwelt between the cherubim, Numbers 7:89, 1 Samuel 4:4, and rides on them, 2 Samuel 22:11. And Solomon placed two cherubim in the Holy of Holies, 1 Kings 6:23-28. And also 1 Kings 8:7. See also Revelation 4:6-9. All right. Now, what seems to be the confusion is I had a talk with one of the Akiam from the GMS Arizona camp, Brother Kaya, and me and Brother Kaya over a year ago. We actually went into this with each other, all right? And he even said and gave me edification on it that, you know, when you deal with the cherubs, they are actually indeed the heavenly host. They're the angels or angelic beings, I should say, right? So to understand this, I want to start here in the book of Psalms, the 18th chapter, all right? And straight to the point, verse 10. Actually, we'll start at verse 9. It says, and he bowed the heavens also and came down, speaking of the Heavenly Father, and darkness was under his feet. Okay, now we understand the Heavenly Father, all right, when it tells you in Ezekiel that he rides, or even in the book of Psalms, that he, you know, he rides upon the cherubs, right? And it's going to tell you in the very next verse. It says, and he rode upon a cherub, and he did fly. Yea, he did fly upon the wings of the wind. Okay, and the wind represents the spirits, all right, which is the angels, because the scriptures talks about how, let's get a precept. Let's get same book, Psalms chapter 104. All right, verses 3 and 4. It says, who layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters? Who maketh the clouds his chariot? Who walketh upon the wings of the wind? Because chariots are also known as a whirlwind. It says, verse 4, who maketh his angels spirits? His ministers a flaming fire. Okay. So anytime you see in the scriptures where it says cherub, chariots, or even whirlwind, all right, for instance, let's go to Ezekiel chapter 10. And actually, it's in chapter 9. Let me see. Salakia. Let me just find it. If we type in whirlwind, and let's see here. Let's see. Yep, Ezekiel chapter 1. That's what it was. Ezekiel chapter 1 and verse 4. It says, and I looked, and behold, a whirlwind came out of the north. All right, now they'll think that that symbolizes, you know, a storm. All right, which when you deal with spirits, all right, such as angels, all right, they come in a form as storms. They can come in a form as a famine. Wild beast, which we'll get the scripture to prove that, right? But it goes on to say, so a whirlwind came out of the north, a great cloud, all right, who maketh his chariots the clouds, right? And a fire enfolding itself, and a brightness was about it, and out of the midst thereof, as the color of amber out of the midst of the fire. So this is a clear indication that this is talking about a chariot, okay, or a cherub, right? Now, as I stated, spirits, which are these angels, coming as a whirlwind, all right? Let's get a precept. Let's get the Apocrypha. And let's get the book of Sirach, chapter 39, just to prove that point in verse 28. It says, there be spirits that are created for vengeance, which in their fury lay on sore strokes. And in a time of destruction, they pour out their force, and appease the wrath of him that made them. And it says, fire and hell and famine and death, all these were created for vengeance. So these angels, all right, when they are given a specific commandment to go down and appease the Most High Yahweh, all right, to seek vengeance, they can come in the form of fire, hell, famine, death. But it also says, verse 30, all right, teeth of wild beast. All right. So spirits can jump into certain animals. All right. To deliver a judgment to somebody. It says, and scorpions and serpents and the sword punishing the wicked to destruction. All right. It says, they, meaning these spirits, these angels, shall rejoice in his commandment, and they shall be ready upon earth when need is. And when their time has come, they shall not transgress his word. All right. And that brings me to another precept. What's Amos, the fifth chapter, I think it is. Amos chapter 5, start at verse 18. The point is at verse 19. It says, woe unto you that desire the day of Yahweh. To what end is it for you? The day of Yahweh is darkness and not light. As if a man did flee from a lion and a bear met him. Why do you think that bear met him? Because we just read, there be spirits that are created for vengeance, teeth of wild beast. Okay, so these spirits, these angels, they can enter in, they can become what's known as an evil spirit, and they can go in and possess animals to set up shop, to fork out judgment onto upon that individual, right? So verse 19, it says, as if a man did flee from a lion and a bear met him, or went into the house and leaned his hand on the wall and a serpent bit him. You see? So, you know, going back to Ezekiel, 1 and 4. So once again, it says, and I looked and behold, a whirlwind came out of the north, a great cloud and a fire enfolding itself, and a brightness was about it, and out of the midst thereof, as the color of amber, out of the midst of fire. All right, because these chariots, okay, they are likened unto fire. Now, I got a video lined up here, all right, and this is from the beloved Manatazak Banyamian 144. Subscribe so that you can be edified. And this was a video that he put out 2 years ago, showing what these chariots or cherubims look like, right? So let's get some more edification on this.
Imagine a technology that can do 600 to 700 G-forces that can fly it.
And you see, those are likened unto amber of fire in terms of their color. And now if I take it back just a tad bit here, that was pretty. Now, if you see in the background there, that little circle color amber-like, that's the same way Ezekiel described it. The color of amber, all right? And these are the chariots, all right? That ride is swift as a cloud. Let's grab that, right? Let's go back to Psalms 18 and 11. It says, and he rode upon a cherub and did fly. Yea, he did fly upon the wings of the wind, all right? And when you go into that word cherub, they clearly tell you what it is, all right? Cherub or cherubim for plural, an angelic being, right? Also as the guardians of Eden, because they guarded the Garden of Eden when Adam was kicked out, which were indeed actual angels, all right? Because you'll have some people that'll say it was statues or whatever with a flaming sword. It wasn't statues. It was an actual, it was actual angels that guarded the Garden of Eden. It says, as flanking God's throne, as an image form you hovering, all right? Salak, let me read that again. As an image form hovering over the Ark of the Covenant, all right? Which when you look up the Ark of the Covenant, it was told to make the image of those, of the cherubims. But also it says here, as the chariot of Yahweh, all right? Because that's what they are, okay? But see, people get confused because when they read, like it says here in Strong's definition, a cherub or an imaginary figure. That's why people say they're not realistic. They're not real beings or existed beings, right? But when you look up the root etymology, which let's go there. This is from Etymology Online, Salakia. It says cherub, late 14th century, as an order of angels. So they are none other than what? Celestial beings. Okay. It says a winged angel, which according to Kling is perhaps related to Akkadian Kerubu, to bless one who blesses. All right. So that's all we need on that, as an order of angels. That's straight cut. This is from the Etymology Online. All right. So I don't know why this is so hard for individuals to get, but we know because, you know, everybody is not under the right teachers. They're not under the right elders and the apostles. Right. Now, when you deal with Psalms 18 and verse 11, let's get some commentary on this. All right. And then we'll come back to the video. But what I wanted to do was let's go to Bible Hub. And I always like to tap into the commentary to get a little bit of more edification. Because sometimes the scholars, they, you know, they on point. Sometimes they go off. But if we drop down to, I think it was, let's see here. Oh, that's the wrong one. Psalms 18 and 11 is what we want. Salak, let's see here. If we drop down, and let's get, let me see. we'll probably get this one here, Elliot's. Maybe it was 10. Salakia. Yeah, Salakia, I had the wrong verse. So 10. Now, in Elliot's commentary for English, it says, Cherub, see also Exodus 25 and 19. This passage alone would show how naturally the idea of wing attendance on the divine being grew out of the phenomena of cloud and storm. No doubt many features of the developed conception were derived from contact with Assyrian art, but for the poetry of this passage, we have only to think of those giant pinions into which cloud so often shapes itself, this clause being in close parallelism with wings of the wind. Now you drop down where it says Mrs. Brownie's translation. It has been, however, conjectured that for a Cherub or cherub, we should read Rakab, chariot, as in Psalms 104 and verse 3. All right. So what they're saying is when you read Psalms 18 and 10, where it talks about he rode upon a cherub, you should swap the word chair for chariot. All right. They're basically the same thing. All right. A cherub. All right. It's the chariot of the of Yahweh, which we looked up in the outline biblical usage of the word cherub. You see, also here in Benson's commentary, it says upon the angels who are so-called, letting you know who the cherub is, Genesis 3 and 24, showing you that there were angelical beings guarding the Garden of Eden. It says, and who are also termed the Most High's chariots. That's a cut right there. So anybody that's going around saying the cherubs are not the angels, you obviously don't know what you're talking about. The cherubs are the angelic beings of Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai. Read it again. Upon the angels who are so-called and who are also termed the Most High's chariots, Psalm 68, 17, upon which he is said to sit and ride, which he, Salakia, which is not to be understood literally, grossly, but only figuratively, to denote the Most High's using the ministry of angels and raising such storms and tempests, as are here described, whether they be interpreted literally or figuratively, and especially in affecting many of those great events which take place in the administrating of his providence, and particularly such as manifest his immediate interposition in the extraordinary judgments by which he punishes sinful nations, or in the remarkable deliverances which he works for his people. All right. And you can really back that up because when you go to Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 7, it says, in the angels and of the angels, he saith, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. Right now, when you go into the commentary on that, let's get Hebrews 1 and 7. I ended up stumbling across this, if I can find it. All right, I think it was here, Barnes Notes. It says, and of the angels, he saith, who maketh his angel spirits, he gives to them an inferior name and assigns to them a more humble office. They are mere ministers and have not ascribed to them the name of son. They have a name which implies a more humble rank in office, the name spirit, and the appellation of a flame of fire. They obey his will as the winds and the lightnings do. All right, and you can get that in Psalms 103 and verse 20. Lord willing, we can grab that. It says, the object of the apostle in this passage is to show that the angels serve the Most High in ministerial capacity as the winds do, while the Son is the Lord of all. The one serves him passively as being wholly under his control. The other acts as a sovereign, as Lord over all, and is addressed and regarded as equal to the equal with the Most High, which he's not equal to Yahweh, because Yahweh Shah is known as the Alpha and the Omega, but Yahweh is known as the Ancient of Days. There's a separation between the two, all right? And the scriptures even tells you that Yahweh Shah thought it not equal, right? Let's grab that. Philippians 2, and we'll start at verse 5. The point is at 6, it says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Hamashiach Yahweh Shai, who being and the form of the Most High, thought it not robbery to be equal with the Most High, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of man. Why? Because it tells you in the very next verse, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. All right. So he was obedient unto his heavenly father, Yahweh. All right. So you got to watch it, because these devils, they'll put little shit in there like that, regarded as the equal with the Most High. We just read in Philippians, he thought it not to be equal with the Heavenly Father. All right. That's the whole purpose of why he came in a lowly estate, to do the will. All right. So you got to watch it when they put in little, you know, shit like that, man. These devils. See, sometimes that's why we always say you got to learn how to take the meat and chew the meat, spit out the bones. You got to know when they're going off. All right. But I think that's all we needed on there. Now, check this out. This is Jameson Fawcett Brown Bible Commentary. Now, it says here, the Greek is rather in reference to the angels, spirits or winds. All right. Which we read in Sirach, the 39th chapter. All right. He maketh his the spirits of vengeance. Right. Roughly paraphrasing. It says, who employeth his angels as the winds, his ministers as the lightnings, or he maketh his angelic ministers the directing powers of winds and flames when these latter are required to perform his will. Now, when you drop down where it says English version, it says maketh his angel spirits means he maketh them of a subtle and corporal nature, swift as the wind. So Psalms 18 and 10, a cherub, the wings of the wind. That's all I wanted to get right there, showing you that they intertwine with one another. Okay, the cherubs are angels. It's just that simple. All right, this is not hard to put together. So let's go back to this video. Take it back a little bit.
Imagine a technology that can do 600 to 700 G-forces, that can fly at 13,000 miles an hour, that it can evade radar, and that can fly through air and water and possibly space. And oh, by the way, has no obvious signs of propulsion, no wings, no control surfaces, and yet still can defy the natural effects of Earth's gravity. That's precisely what we're seeing. I'm
pretty sure they... Precisely what we're seeing, but yet let them tell you that they shot down, what was it, about a month and a half, 2 months ago, that they recently had shot down a so-called UFO or UAP, which we know them to be the chariots, and that they actually had encountered alien-like beings or whatever. Esau is a goddamn lie, man. You ain't shot down no chariot, nothing like that. You're talking about the vehicles of the Heavenly Father that is on a whole nother level, which that's the same guy that they interviewed in a 60-minute clip. He even went on to say, those vehicles are beyond a thousand years within technology that we don't even have, nor do we possess. So how the hell can you have shot down? It don't make any sense, right? Let me show you something. You claim to have shot down that, but this says different.
Soared above an unfamiliar region in China, a passenger gazed out of the window, capturing a captivating video. A sense of awe and curiosity filled the air as the passenger's camera focused on a peculiar sight, a disc-shaped object.
You see that, man? Now, here it is, Esau telling you that they shot down. If any brother has that clip, just, you know, drop the link on a comment board, and so people can go and see it for themselves. But when they held that meeting, dealing with the whole UFOs, the guy claimed that they had shot down one of them. Well, you mean to tell me the way that this chariot right here saw the missile, anticipated the missile ahead of time, right? Let's watch it again.
Capturing a captivating video. A sense of awe and curiosity filled the air as the passenger's camera focused on a peculiar sight. A disc.
Man, come on, man. That was lightweight. That was lightweight. You cannot stop the power of Yahweh Bashim Yahushai.
Object, about the size of a small car, effortlessly gliding in parallel to the airplane, near one of its wings. The crispness of the video allowed the viewer to perceive the details of the disc distinctly. As seconds passed, an intriguing occurrence took place. The mysterious object seemed to activate a device of some sort, creating a mesmerizing effect. Space and time itself appeared to fold around the disc, as if the laws of physics were being bent to its will. The passenger's video captured the surreal moment in all its glory, a testament to an encounter that defied conventional understanding. As the object sped away from the aircraft, its velocity accelerated to a staggering 24,000 miles per hour, leaving an indelible impression on the mind of the witness.
And see, this is what they're scared. This is the reason why they made their six army, I like to call it, within the heavens, that space army, because they know who's coming back, man. Okay? And see, Jake, you don't believe in Yahweh Bashim Al-Shah, but guess what? This is our army in the heavens. Okay? And this is the same reason why when you get the... let's get, what's that, 1 Kings chapter 2, or actually, I think it's 2 Kings, Salakia. Let's get 2 Kings 2, yep. Now, this is when Elisha needed, you know, some clarification, because when they were outnumbered, all right, Elijah prayed for Elisha's eyes to be open, okay, for him to see the help that we had. So when you read it, let me see if I can find it in this account. Let me see here. Salaki, let me find it. I don't think it's in this chapter. Yep, it's the sixth chapter, Salaki. So now watch this. This is 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 16, because let this be a faith boost to you Israelites out there, man, because this is our salvation. It says, verse 16, and he answered, "Fear not, for they that be with us," talking about the chariots, all right, the Alahayim, "are more than they that be with them," all right, and it's talking about of the other nations, because you got to think, even today in 2023, Esau has all this technology, he has all the ground footmen, the soldiers, okay, but these heathens are in for a rude awakening, man, right? It says, and Elisha prayed and said, "Yahweh, I pray thee, open his eyes, that he may see." And Yahweh opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. So he saw a barrage of chariots, right? And Lord's will, I'll put the TikTok video in post-production at the end of this lesson, so you can see, all right, a mountain full of horses and chariots, all right, a fire roundabout, all right, that Elisha described, because there's a video clip that I have where they actually show out in space, one of their satellite feeds picked up thousands of chariots. It says, and when they came down to him, Elisha prayed unto Yahweh and said, "Smite this people, I pray thee, with blindness," and he smote them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. So just as he told the young man, or he prayed for the young man, for, you know, Yahweh to open up his eyes to see that there's more of the chariots than there are of, you know, the other nations' military here on the earth. It's the same thing with us in these last days, man. There's more of us, all right, from, you know, up above the firmament in the heavens than there are of ground men here on the planet earth. You know, and you have to understand that and believe that, man. All right. Because they're going to lose. This is why it tells you not to digress. But I got to grab this Revelation 12 and 9. It says, and a great dragon, all right, ancient Roman Empire, Esau, Edom, was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the world, and he was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And that's going into really his military. Because when you go up a couple of verses, it says, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels. This is the reason why they've created. When you look up, let's find that real quick. Let's get Google. And you look up U.S. space. Yeah, when you look up United States Space Force, right? This is their their Space Force. Space Force Delta. All right, founded December 20th, 2019, 3 years ago. It says the United States Space Force is a space service branch of the U.S. Armed Forces and the world's first space force. Along with the U.S. Air Force, the Space Force is part of the Department of the Air Force led by the Secretary of the Air Force. The military heads of the Space Force are the Chief of Space Operations, who is one of the Joint Chiefs of Staff and Vice Chief of Space Operations. Why the hell would you need a Space Force if you didn't know who was coming? Just a question. You know? Why in the hell would you need a Space Force, all right, if you don't know who's coming? You see? So this is that war that's going to come, all right? And we in that time, all right? Because Michael, all right, when you look up Michael's name, it means who is like the Most High, or Yahweh, right? Michael, who is like the Most High, the first of the chief princes of archangels, who is supposed to be the guardian angel of the Israelites. So you know, man, you know it's finna be bad when Yahweh Shai is coming with the prince of war, which is Michael. That's why it tells you in Daniel, the 12th chapter, okay? Are we dealing with these angels, man? Daniel 12, the time of the end, it says, and at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince, which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation even to that same time. And at that time, thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. So it's going to get so bad that Michael, he got us, man. Okay, all we got to do is just steadfast and believe and have the faith and endure until the end, man. Yahweh Shah said that he's going to be with us even until the end. So we ain't got nothing to worry about. You see, but see, Jake, you know, wants to be carnal minded, and they think that strength is in numbers. All right. But the Lord ain't dealing with strength in numbers. All right. The scripture says the just shall live by faith. Habakkuk 2 and verse 4. Behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not upright in him. Speaking of Esau. But the just shall live by his faith. And the scripture says, we walk by faith and not by sight. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. You see? So, ooh, man. So let's close it out. Let's get Ezekiel the 10th chapter. Ezekiel 10 and 1, it says, then I looked and behold in the firmament that was above the head of the cherubims, all right, chariots, there appeared over them as it were a sapphire stone, as the appearance of the likeness of a throne. And he spake unto the man clothed with linen, which that man clothed with linen was speaking of an angel. Because when you go back to the 9th chapter, all right, he had, where it says here, verse 11, and behold, the man clothed with linen, which had the inkhorn by his side, reported the matter, saying, I have done as thou hast commanded me, because he was told to go and mark the children of Israel that sigh and cry. Okay, this was an angel. All right, so when you go back and read chapter 9, it'll make sense. So Ezekiel 10 and 2, it says, and he spake unto the man clothed with linen and said, go in between the wheels, all right, even under the cherub, and fill thy hand with coals of fire from between the cherubims and scatter them over the city. And he went in my sight. Now, you have what's called Ezekiel's will, which this video right here. All right. Matter of fact, I'll just, well, I don't want to play the sound, but because if I play the sound, YouTube will cut it off. So I'll just play it like this without the sound. All right, because, you know, YouTube, they cracking down a lot on videos and stuff like that. So as you can see, this was picked up on a satellite. Now, this was back in 2020 or 2021. All right. And you see, you got Earth, and then you have this big chariot, which, you know, they call it Ezekiel's wheel, a wheel inside of a wheel. All right. That's like four times the size of the Earth, man. All right. The fathership, we like to call it. All right. And this was picked up from the satellite, and NASA, they cut the footage. All right. Now, this video is very hard to find on the internet. And luckily, I saved it before they took the video down, because you can't even find it. You might be able to find it on other platforms like BitChute or Odyssey. But it seems, though, like if you try to load it on like YouTube or any other platforms that are known, they seem to cut it and take it down. All right. So hopefully they don't take this video down, even though I played it without the sound, because normally if you play it with the sound, they'll cut it. All right. So, all right. That's, you know, something that you can link visually so that you can understand what the scriptures is saying. All right. So verse 3, it says, now the cherubim stood on the right side of the house when the man went in, and a cloud filled the inner court. All right. Then the glory of Yahweh went up from the cherub and stood over the threshold of the house, and the house was filled with the cloud, and the court was full of his brightness of Yahweh's glory. All right. It's talking about those chariots. And verse 5, and the sound of the cherubim's wings was heard even to the outer court as the voice of the almighty power when he speaketh. Now, one thing I want to make perfectly clear, when you read Ezekiel, the first chapter, Ezekiel describes, all right, these cherubs. But in Ezekiel, the first chapter, they're not known as cherubs. He just describes them here at verse 15, living creatures. OK, but when you jump to chapter 10, all right, he gives more emphasis of these living creatures and who they were. Because when you drop down to verse 9, it says, and when I looked, behold, the four wheels by the cherubims, one wheel by one cherub, and another wheel by another cherub, and the appearance of the wheels was as the color of a beryl stone. And as for their appearances, they four had one likeness, as if a wheel had been in the midst of a wheel. Okay? So, dropping down to verse 14, it says, and everyone had four faces. The first face was the face of a cherub, and the second face was the face of a man, and the third, the face of a lion, and the fourth, the face of an eagle. Same thing going back to Ezekiel, the first chapter. All right. And in verse 15, the main point, it says, and the cherubims were lifted up. This is the living creature that I saw. So there you have it. They're angelic beings. So anybody saying that the cherubs are not angels, are not angelic beings, you don't know what you're talking about. You have absolutely no idea what the hell you're talking about. All right. So I'm going to leave it off there. Lord willing, this was a edifying lesson, and that you got some edification out of, you know, what cherubims are. So with that, all praise, glory, and honor be to Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, Bahashem, Rakak, Wadash. Double honors to the apostles and elders of GMS, better known as Great Millstone, who rule well. Peace and salutations unto the hopeful elect. Lord willing, I'll see you on the next side. Shalom.